Hi, and welcome to Acquire in the Desert. My next video was supposed to be about the 7 days Adventist, but I'm still in the process of gathering material, which could take some months. This is something I do in my spare time, so I hope you have a little patience with me. And if you are a 7 days Adventist, don't be scared. I don't consider the 7 days Adventist to be a brainwashed cult like the Jehovah's Witnesses. However, as I have done with my own background, the charismatic movement, I'm going to expose certain false doctrines. Before the video about the 7 days Adventist will be published, I believe God has led two other video subjects on my heart, which needs to be addressed. One is about the life after death, and the other about diet. Although Jesus declared all food clean, some denominations teach that we shouldn't eat this and others teach that we should abstain from that. And right now there's a teaching out coming from the Baptist Church that a vegan diet is satanic and contrary to the Word of God. I'll make an attempt to clean up this mess of confusion. Now, in this video, I'll talk about how my mom, who was a Christian, died. My mom was born in 1932 and became a Christian in 1971 when she was exposed to a supernatural occurrence. The event happened the summer of 1971 when a Christian friend invited her to a Christian summer camp. My mom was this kind of open-minded person who didn't have any prejudices against other people's belief or political orientation. It was out of pure curiosity that she went to that summer camp, which was located off-road in the countryside, just about 10 miles outside the small city where she lived. But that day it rained heavily, and it was simply impossible to read the road signs. In her mind, she had already given up finding the place and was ready to turn around and drive back, when suddenly the clouds divided and a beam of sunlight hit a sign reading "Summer Camp." She somehow knew that this was a sign from God, and that day she decided to become a Christian. At that time I was 6 years old. My father had left when I was four, so my mom had to raise me, her only child, on her own. My mom was a nurse, and things were not always easy. I remember many times that we didn't have money for food and clothes, but I never went to bed hungry, because God was faithful and has always been faithful to this day. God always sent help when we needed it most. God protected my mom. My mom had a cousin who was married to a wealthy man. She was an atheist, and her husband had a high position in city council. That cousin despised Christians. Because of my mom's belief in Jesus and her apparent inadequate financial situation, she had planned to use the power of her husband's position in the city council to get me removed by force and adopted into a wealthy family. My mom, who was informed about what was going on, prayed for that cousin, and later God struck that cousin with terminal cancer. At her last days before she died, my mom stayed with her. She prayed for her, and that cousin became a Christian before she died. Praise God! Now, 46 years later, on June 1st, my mom turned 85. All these years I have known my mom as a God-fearing person who read the Bible, prayed, and always gave out of generosity of the little she had to both church and to the people around her who were in need. I remember one day my mom received a tax return, but instead of spending it on herself, she gave it to a single mother so she could go and buy new clothes for her children. Now, let me get to the point. A couple of weeks ago, my mom got a serious infection. And a friend of hers found her in her house, lying on her bed, fighting for her life. My mom was speedily brought to a hospital in an ambulance, and I was informed that her chances of survival were very slim due to her old age. For me, it was very frustrating because my mom lives in Scandinavia and I was on duty in West Africa for another month without any chance of getting time off. I decided to pray to God the Almighty. Next morning, Sunday the 11th of June, God sent the answer. At 10 a.m. I received a very surprising text message on my phone from my boss. And the text message said that if I wanted to go and see my wife in the period between the 11th and the 17th of June, I could do that. That was very surprising because my boss knew nothing about my mom's condition, and because in the 8 years I have worked in Africa, it has never happened before that my boss has given me time off outside my roster. But then another miracle happened. There were no airline tickets available on the search machine we normally use to buy airline tickets. I tried many different options, but the first available seat was on Tuesday the 14th, landing on the 15th, which didn't make sense as I had to return on the 16th in order to be back on duty on the 17th. However, after having browsed for a while, I finally managed to find a company which had one seat left for sale, departing on Sunday, and I booked it immediately. But the homepage didn't allow me to pay online, but requested that I should go to an office downtown to pay within 3 hours, else the booking would be cancelled. The ticket office, depending on traffic, was about 2.5 hours drive away from where I stay. And when I looked up the opening hours, it appeared that it was closed on Sundays. I called the head office in France and was put on hold for 40 minutes before I finally got through to somebody who informed me that I should go to an office in the airport, which would open at 4 p.m. I explained that at 4 p.m. the booking would have been cancelled, and I was put on hold again. I now spoke with another person who said that they were trying to see if they could extend the booking to later, and then I lost the telephone connection. It was very frustrating and time was running, and I called the office again. And after another long waiting time, I was now informed that they had managed to extend the booking to 7 p.m., which was the check-in time for the flight. I called the company driver and was at the office at the airport at 4 p.m. and was standing in a long queue. Around 5 p.m. it was my turn, and the friendly lady at the counter told me that my ticket had been cancelled and there were no more seats available. But your head office promised to keep the booking open to 7 p.m., I objected. But the nice lady showed me her computer screen, which clearly showed that the booking had been cancelled 3 hours previously. I said to her, "This is really bad. I mean, your company promised to keep the booking open to 7. You have to do something about it." "Let me try KLM," she said. I already knew that there were no economy tickets left at KLM because I have checked it out. The remaining tickets were way too expensive for my salary. The lady confirmed my fear when she said, "I have one ticket left, but that is another price. Can you accept that?" "How much?" I asked, and she gave me a price, $3 less than the ticket I had already booked. Glory to God. I now rushed back to my residence to pick up my suitcase, and some hours later, when I boarded the aircraft, I saw that it was full to the brim. Not one single seat was left. That was when I realized that God wanted me to see my mom. Although the enemy had canceled my booking, God had received a seat for me. Praise God. After a short stop in Amsterdam, I landed in Scandinavia the next day and brought my family to the hospital. My mom had not been eating for 14 days at that point and was only skin and bones. Her arms were blue from internal bleedings and she had problems breathing. She had been unable to talk for days and the nurses had told me that her heart and kidneys were partly failed and that she could die soon. I was angry in my spirit. How could they say that my mom would die soon? I went to her bed and woke her up. Although she was very weak, she smiled, but I could see in her eyes that she had given up too. I had brought some of her favorite foods, and next day I brought her a homemade Hokkaido soup, which I forced her to eat. That was the first decent meal she had had in 14 days. My wife and I started to pray for her, and after some time my mom fell asleep with a smile on her face. Next day my mom looked a lot better. I could see that she had been eating of some of the foodstuff I brought the first day. Her color had changed, and she was able to sit up and talk. We prayed with her again, and the next couple of days she became stronger and stronger. And on the 15th, she has been out of bed and she had been eating a bowl of sliced fruit and she wanted to eat potatoes and a fish cake. My mom was back to normal. Praise God. My mom and I were talking and taking pictures of me and her and my wife, and my mom was happy. The nurses were amazed. I heard that they were talking about that when her son came back, she all of a sudden started to feel better. On the 16th in the morning, I went back to Africa on duty. I was convinced that my mom had cheated death, but God had other plans. I landed very late in Africa, and the next day I was told that my mom had encountered another infection, worse than the first one. What? Why, God? I mean, you healed her from the first one. So, why now another infection? I called the hospital and the nurses told me that the chances for her to survive were slim because her kidneys were too weak for treatment with antibiotics. The following day, my mom became unconscious. And on the 22nd of June, the doctor wanted to talk to me. He told me that my mom had multiple organ failures and that her brain was damaged to the point where there was no longer any response from her. In other words, my mom was brain dead. My wife was at the hospital and I asked her to direct the FaceTime camera at my mom so I could see her condition with my own eyes. My mom was lying on her side, not moving, except that I could see that she was breathing slowly. One eye was half open without any movement, and the other eye was closed. Previously, I had worked with deadly sick people, so I know what that meant, severe brain damage. I now realized why my mom didn't respond to any stimuli. My wife and another fellow Christian was there with her, and they began to sing Christian hymns and pray. While praying, a miracle happened. My mom suddenly lifted up her head, opened both of her eyes and smiled to my wife and the other fellow Christian. Her eyes were full of life, and she looked up in the air with a triumphing smile, as if she had seen something. She now closed her eyes, let down her head on the pillow, and stopped breathing. One of the people who saw my mom die called me on the phone and said, "I know for sure that there's a life after death." It was so clear that your mom saw Jesus and then transitioned into heaven. I don't know what my mom saw, but I know for sure that she had made it. Not because of her own righteousness, but because she trusted in Jesus who died on the cross in our place for our sins. Jesus said, "He who believes in me shall live, even if he dies." Jesus hanging on that cross in unbelievable pains made a promise to the person hanging next to him. The promise was a zealot who was convicted for uproar, and he had asked Jesus, "Lord, remember me when you come into your kingdom." Lord, remember me. And the response from Jesus was, "Assuredly, I say to you, today you will be with me in paradise." Let me tell you the truth about what happens after you die. Luke chapter 16, verses 19 to 22. There was a certain rich man who was clothed in purple and fine linen and lived in luxury every day. But there was a certain beggar named Lazarus, full of sores, who was laid at his gate, desiring to be fed with the crumbs which fell from the rich man's table. Moreover, the dogs came and licked his sores. So it was that the beggar died and was carried by the angels to Abraham's bosom. Now, what happened when Lazarus died? Yes, you are right. He was carried by the angels to a place of comfort named Abraham's bosom. I'm convinced that when my mom looked up, she saw the angels coming for her. Or maybe she even saw Jesus. Remember that two Christians were singing and praying for her. And the Bible says that where two or three are gathered together in my name, I'm in the midst of them. We all know that we all have to die. And I have decided that when I die, I want to do the same transition into glory which my mom did. At this point, I'm even envious of her, as Paul expressed it, Philippians chapter 1, verses 21 to 24. For to me to live is Christ, and to die is gain. But if I live on in the flesh, this will mean fruit from my labor. Yet what shall I choose? I cannot tell, for I am hard pressed between the two, having a desire to depart and be with Christ, which is far better. Nevertheless, to remain in the flesh is more needful for you. Now, let's continue to read from Luke chapter 16 to see what happened to the rich, selfish guy who every day saw Lazarus in his sufferings, but didn't take care of him. Luke chapter 16, verses 22 to 26. The rich man also died and was buried. And being in torments in Hades, he lifted up his eyes and saw Abraham afar off and Lazarus in his bosom. And then he cried out and said, "Father Abraham, have mercy on me, and send Lazarus that he may dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue, for I am tormented in this flame." But Abraham said, "Son, remember that in your lifetime you received your good things, and likewise Lazarus' evil things. But now he is comforted and you are tormented. And besides all of this, between us and you there is a great gulf fixed, so that those who want to pass from here to you cannot, nor can those from there pass to us." Notice that the rich man also did a transition after death, but that was to another place in which he was in torment. Nobody likes to hear what I'm going to say now, but I feel that I have to do it. Jesus ended his Olivet discourse by saying, Matthew chapter 25 verse 46, and these will go away into everlasting punishment, but the righteous into eternal life. I've attached the link in the description box below to a song by Keith Green, which I highly recommend that you watch, whether you are Christian or not. I would have liked to show it in this video, but I'm afraid that the copyright people will take it down. I know that Keith Green himself, who is now with the Lord, wouldn't mind. When Keith Green was alive, he was more concerned about how to help the poor than he was about copyrights and making money. He's the only famous singer I know of who housed 65 homeless people in his own private estate and cancelled his contract with Sparrow Records in order to make a record free of charge. With the advertising, "You can't buy me." Okay, that was a little sidestep back to the everlasting punishment and the eternal life. Most people today claim that there's no life after death, and there are Christians who claim that there's no hell or no eternal punishment. These Christians simply interpret the Greek word kolasis, which means punishment or torment, into something else which fit better into their imagination. Or they interpret the Greek word aionios, which means eternal, everlasting, or forever, into something else which is not forever. The reason for that kind of translation is that some Christians reason: how can a good God punish someone forever? You see, the problem with that is that when Jesus was talking in Matthew's chapter 19, verse 29 about inheriting everlasting life, he used the very same word, aionios. And even in the same verse in Matthew's chapter 25, verse 46, he used the word aionios for both the everlasting punishment as well as the everlasting life, the eternal life. How can the same word mean something else in the same context? Does that mean that the everlasting life is not forever, if someone chooses to interpret it that way? Do you see the problem? Whether we like it or not, we have to accept God's word for what it is, for what it says. Let me tell you the truth. Neither heaven nor hell care one bit about your belief system. If heaven and hell is real, it is real. If eternal life and eternal punishment is real, it is real. And there's nothing you can do about it. Your opinion doesn't count. You can choose to interpret it differently, but it doesn't change the fact. Hell simply doesn't disappear because you think that it doesn't exist. It doesn't disappear because you think you are right. When you go to heaven, you can discuss the interpretation of God. But for now, you better believe what the Bible says. Consequently, get your priorities right. I'm talking to myself as much as I'm talking to you. Jesus said, Matthew chapter 16, verse 26, "For what profit is it to man if he gains the whole world and loses his own soul? Or what will a man give in exchange for his soul?" Was the way my mom died just a romantic way of describing death? No. There are many testimonies around the world about Christians who died under supernatural circumstances. Consider the way Stephen the Martyr died. Acts chapter 7, verses 55 to 60. "But he," Stephen, "being full of the Holy Spirit, gazed into heaven and saw the glory of God and Jesus standing at the right hand of God, and said, 'Look, I see heavens opened and the Son of Man standing at the right hand of God.' Then they cried out with a loud voice, stopped their ears, and ran at him with one accord, and they cast him out of the city and stoned him. And the witnesses let down their clothes at the feet of a young man named Saul. And they stoned Stephen as he was calling on God, saying, Lord Jesus, receive my spirit. He knelt down and cried out with a loud voice, Lord, do not charge them with this sin. And when he had said this, he fell asleep. May God help us. Now, if you are a Christian who hasn't got your priorities right, or you are an unbeliever who wants your sins to be forgiven, and you want to be reconciled with God, and you want to have your name written in the book of life, then close your eyes and pray with me. In the mighty name of Jesus, Lord Jesus, you who bore the sin of the world through your sufferings on the cross, I'm standing here before you, asking you to cleanse me from sin. Let your Holy Spirit move into my heart and make me a new and sin-free creation. Give me the power and will to follow you and to live a life worthy of your kingdom. I commit my life into your mighty hands. Let my life here on earth be to your glory, not according to my own selfish will and desires which lead to death, but according to your spirit, your life which leads to life. In the mighty name of Jesus I have prayed. If you prayed with me, go and find yourself a Christian fellowship in which you can make a difference. And if you don't know where to go, ask God to lead you. For now, my mom's spirit is kept in a better place, waiting for the glorious day when Jesus will return to establish his kingdom. That day, my mom's body, which dwells in the dust, will be resurrected together with all the righteous. Isaiah chapter 26, verse 19. But your dead will live. Lord, their bodies will rise. Let those who dwell in the dust wake up and shout for joy. Your dew is like the dew of the morning. The earth will give birth to her dead. Thank you for watching, and God bless you.